good that mic works.
Yeah.
And she's lapelled up. All right, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. Welcome to the Vancouver Aquarium Evening Lecture Series. Tonight's program is a natural history of sea otters. Earlier today, I was thinking about going and get my hair cut, but since we're talking about the furriest creatures in the animal kingdom tonight, I thought I would keep it on. Sea otters were once prized for their thick furs and were hunted to near extinction into the early 1900s. And international efforts led to their protection, and now populations have grown quite a bit. Unfortunately, not everybody's happy about it. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Jane Watson. She grew up on the BC coast, studied at UBC and the University of California at Santa Cruz. She's a research associate at the Vancouver Aquarium. She is an adjunct professor at the UBC Marine Mammal Unit and a biology professor at the Vancouver Island University. She spent 25 years studying sea otters along the BC coast. If you could help me welcome her tonight, Dr. Jane Watson.
Okay, so you'll have to forgive me. I have a really good outdoor voice, and I'm not good at microphones. And so I apologize to those of you who are only listening to me through a microphone. So what I'd like to do this evening is talk a little bit about sea otters in general. I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of sea otters on the BC coast. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the biology of otters, and then, having drawn you all in, because I'm going to talk about nice, fuzzy, warm animals, I'm going to proceed to tell you all about kelp, because that's really what I work on. And to a large degree, you're going to discover that the story of sea otters is largely a story about kelp. And the first thing I'd like to point out is that we come here to talk about sea otters largely because they were hunted to virtual extinction. This quote up here came from the journal of Captain La Perouse, who was a French naval captain who sort of emulated James Cook in his journeys around the world. He liked to bring naturalists with him. He liked to write prolific notes in his journal. And in his journal, he notes that when he traveled the west coast of North America, sea otters were probably as common as the seals on the east coast of North America. And I don't know if anyone's been to the east coast of North America, but there are an awful lot of seals. He made that quote in 1786. In 1810, Captain John Ebbets was sending a letter to his boss, John Astor, who was a furrier. John Ebbets ran a ship called the Enterprise, which actually hunted and traded in sea otter pelts. And he reported to Astor that here was 1810, 24 years later, that sea otters are virtually extinct. And so we went from something that was incredibly prolific to something that was very rare. When Europeans first arrived on the west coast of what is now North America, they encountered a culture that was really well-versed in trading and harvesting sea otter pelts. And certainly in the area I work on the west coast of Vancouver Island, sea otter cloaks were the fur that high-ranking individuals wear. They were chiefly garments. So they were well aware, the First Nations people along our coast were well aware of the value of sea otters. But it really wasn't until Europeans arrived on the west coast of North America that we entered into a stage of commercial hunts. And so from about 1778 up until 1850 along our coast, there was an intensive maritime fur trade for sea otters. And we'll probably never know exactly how many sea otters there were in British Columbia, but we can easily account for 55,000 sea otters being harvested in the first 20 years of the sea otter fur trade. Some of those animals may have come from the States and been landed in Canada, but likewise some of the Canadian otters may have been landed in the States. My colleague Linda Nicol at DFO plunged into the archives and found that at the peak of the fur otter trade, which would have been 1799 to 1801, 12,000 sea otters a year were harvested in British Columbia. So what we know is there were a tremendous number of otters. And it's hard to understand how you would go from 55, whatever many thousands it was, to virtually none. But the fact of the matter is these pelts were incredibly valuable. When Linda went hunting around in the archives, she had a friend of ours, a fellow named Brian Gisborne, who was checking through the newspapers at the Victoria Archives looking for sea otter information. And he found record of two pelts that were sold in Victoria in the early 1900s. He looked at the value of those pelts and thought, I have no idea what that means in $1912 or $1920. So he flipped to the back of the newspaper and looked at the classifieds. And what he found was those two sea otters sold in the early 1900s for the same amount of money as you needed to buy a house on 1 acre of land with a stables, with servants' quarters, in downtown Victoria. So that's how you go to hunt an animal to extinction. It becomes so valuable that hunting for the last one is worth it. The last sea otter that we know about in British Columbia was shot in 1929, but by then sea otters had been protected, and they were protected under terms of an international fur trade agreement, which really was set out to protect fur seals. So sea otters were protected in 1911. There were probably fewer than 2,000 sea otters left throughout their North Pacific range. They were in 13 small populations. By 1929, sea otters had been extirpated from British Columbia. That would have been the end of the sea otter story, except for a strange twist of fate. And oddly enough, that was the testing of atomic bombs in the Aleutian Islands. And some of you will remember in the late 1960s, the US government started doing underground testing of nuclear devices in the Aleutian Islands. And the Aleutian Islands were one of these places where there was still a few sea otters. So to try and mitigate the effects of these underground blasts, the Atomic Energy Commission of the United States suggested that some of the otters be captured and translocated to portions of their historic range. And so from 1969 to 1972, British Columbia was the recipient of 89 sea otters. And they came in a series of three translocations. The first two were probably not that successful, but certainly the third one would have been. They were released into this location here, the Bunsby Islands, which is on Chucklesett Bay on the west coast of Vancouver Island. In the first translocation, the animals were flown from Amchitka. When they finally got to the Bunsby Islands, they probably weren't in great shape. In the second translocation, they brought them by ship from Prince William Sound. But partway on their way to British Columbia, the G.B. Reid, the DFO vessel, ran into a big storm. And the sea otters did what sea otters do when the weather is rough. They all gathered together in one of the tanks that was on the deck of the ship. And they also do what sea otters do when they're scared. They got rid of what they had inside them. And so those animals, when they arrived in Chucklesett Bay, were probably not in great shape either. But in the third translocation, when they brought the sea otters down, they flew them, they delivered them very quickly to Chucklesett Bay, and they were held in these floating net pens prior to their release. And it's probably these last 42 animals that gave rise to many of the sea otters that we have in British Columbia. And sea otters have done really well. The population has grown at its maximum rate of about, of about 18%. It's starting to level out right now, and that's largely because sea otters are controlled by their food. And so once they start to run out of food, portions of the population reach equilibrium and no longer start to increase. And so most of the growth in a sea otter population is occurring at its edges. So in British Columbia, we now have in the order of 5,000 to 6,000 sea otters. So not only has the population grown, it's also spread. So here's the original translocation site right here. It spread all the way down to about Euclulit in Barkley Sound, down past Port Hardy on the inside of Vancouver Island, and there's also a population of otters on the central coast of British Columbia. The population has grown in the order of about 18% a year, and people don't think that's very much, but what that means is it means the sea otter population is doubling every 4 years. So that's a tremendous rate of population growth. So I do want to make a point, however, that I've given you a beautiful graph. I've told you that there are about 5,000 to 6,000 sea otters. What we really know is we know the trend of sea otters, because sea otters are extremely difficult to count. This is a DFO survey. That's Graham Ellis sitting right there. That's me. And this right here is a group of sea otters. And we're supposed to figure out how many there are. And this is me counting sea otters. There's a bunch in there. You're supposed to figure out how many there are. And this is a raft from the air. And I'd need everyone to stand up and down, go up and down like this, and go back side to side and count. Okay, so those are very, very rough estimates of the number of otters. But what we know is the population is doing well. The question really is, the interesting question really is how many sea otters were there? And Ed Greger and a variety of us got together a number of years ago and looked at how many sea otters there were in Chucklesit Bay, where we know they're at equilibrium. We looked at the habitat characteristics of Chucklesit Bay, and then we tried to map those same habitat characteristics along the west coast of Vancouver Island and estimate how many otters there might have been historically. And the suggestion is there were probably 5,000 to 6,000 sea otters along the west coast of Vancouver Island, a number that surprisingly agrees with some of the information we have from the harvest records. The question you all should be asking is, why have sea otters done so well? Population doubling every 4 years, that's quite remarkable. And there's really a number of characteristics that sea otters have that have allowed the population to grow so fast. One of the first reasons is that they have a really young age at first reproduction. So sea otters can start reproducing as young as age 3. By age 5, every female sea otter in the population is reproducing. They have one pup every year. They reproduce till at least the age of 15. They're really good mothers. They often lose their first pup, but they manage to wean almost all of their subsequent pups. And for those of you who have grandchildren, you know that if you have children when you're 16, and then your daughter starts to have children when she's 16, and so on and so forth, you have a family that grows very, very quickly. And so this young age at first reproduction is one of the major characteristics that has allowed the population to grow so quickly. There are very few things that eat sea otters, so we have a very low pup mortality. Eagles will take pups, but really not at a level that affects their population. And of course, there's this story that sea otters are killed by killer whales. I have a matrimonial obligation to watch killer whales. My husband has worked on killer whales for the last 40 years of his life. And so every time I'm doing something that involves sea otters and I see a killer whale, I have to stop the sea otter stuff and watch the killer whales. And in my 27 or 28 years of watching killer whales and sea otters, I have seen no kills whatsoever. I have seen 2 incidences of killer whales harassing sea otters, but all that resulted was 2 very, very neurotic sea otters. They swam away quite happily, well, not happily, but they swam away at the end of it. So there is an idea out there that killer whales may prey on sea otters, but there's certainly no evidence that that occurs in British Columbia. Killer whales, like animals with lots of blubber. Sea otters, as I'm going to tell you shortly, lack blubber. My husband calls sea otters dental floss. Okay, and the third thing that really has allowed sea otter populations to grow quite rapidly is abundant food. When we extirpated sea otters from British Columbia, and they were probably ecologically extinct by about 1850, we removed the major predator that controlled the abundance of invertebrates on this coast. So for the ensuing 150 years, there was very little going on in terms of invertebrate predation. So when we reintroduced sea otters into the environment, we reintroduced them into an environment in which the larder was full. Invertebrates in the past 150 years have become exceptionally abundant and exceptionally large. Sea otters need to eat lots, and they do well in areas where they haven't been for a long time. So that kind of brings me to why sea otters are so special. And there's really a number of characteristics of sea otters that make them quite unique. Sea otters are, I've got some pelts here for those of you that are actually here. You can come up and look at them. Sea otters are surprisingly big. They're about the size of a German shepherd. So a big male is about 45 kilograms. And that's not too surprising, but the remarkable thing is that's tiny if you want to live in the marine environment. It gives you a huge surface area. The other remarkable thing about sea otters is they lack that thick blubber layer that we find in all of the other marine mammals. And instead, these guys depend on a thick fur to keep themselves warm. They have fur that is far thicker than any other mammal, about 1 million hairs per square inch. That's per 6 centimeters squared. For those of you guys who are all looking puzzled, for the young women in this room, you have 100,000 hairs on your head. I'm not going to talk too much about the older men. A cat has 120,000 hairs on its entire body. So it's a tremendous amount of hair. And what the otters do is they actually blow air into that hair. The fur captures the air and forms an insulating barrier against the cold water. But to heat that air, they also need to run their bodies at really high temperatures. So it turns out that sea otters also eat a lot. They eat about 20 to 25% of their body weight each day. The hungriest young man in here probably does 2 to 3% of his body weight each day. So this is a tremendous amount of food. And that's why they're special, and that's why we're going to get to kelp. I do have to make one little diversion, though, and that's to point out that there are otters roaming around coastal waters of Vancouver, and these are river otters, and I always like to point out the river otters, members of the same family, but they're much smaller. A river otter is about 13 kilograms. These guys spend a lot of time on land. They have webbed feet. A sea otter has flipper-shaped feet, its hind limbs anyway. These guys den on land, give birth to up to 4 young. A female sea otter gives birth to 1 young. She does so in the water, and she rarely comes ashore. And when you're looking at their skulls, the top there is a river otter. They have typical carnivore teeth. You can see nice shearing teeth for ripping fish apart. And this is a sea otter skull. These are rounded. It's called bunodont dentition. And this is what allows sea otters to crush their prey. And sea otters, of course, are invertebrate specialists. They have those round crushing teeth for breaking open hard-bodied prey. And because they eat so much, they have a profound effect on the coastal ecosystems in which they live. So this is a suite of the types of things that sea otters eat. But of course, they're most famous for eating urchins. And this is a large red sea urchin. And to eat an urchin, sea otters often flip them up on their backs so they can get in at the oral surface where their spines are shortest. And I'm going to refer to these as otterized urchins. You'll often find these things floating around like little boats where sea otters have been recently. Sea urchins in British Columbia are really, really important in rocky subtidal areas. They are the species that is capable of regulating both the distribution and the abundance of fleshy seaweed. So in BC, on rocky shorelines, where there are no sea otters, the downward extent of fleshy algae, things like kelp, is dependent on how far up the urchins can climb. And that depends on things like how rough it is, how wave-washed it is. And so throughout much of British Columbia, in areas without sea otters, we end up with a system that we refer to as an urchin barrens. And these are areas where there are lots and lots of large red urchins, or urchins, and very little fleshy algae. Urchin abundance can get quite high. This is a picture taken by Lynn Lee up in Haida Gwaii. When sea otters move into an area, they feed initially on the largest and most abundant prey they can find. A friend of mine, Aaron Recksteiner, is busy watching sea otters feeding on the Central Coast, and sure enough, the first thing they eat when they arrive in a new area is urchins. Once the urchins get removed, it's a bit like driving the cows out of the pasture and locking the gate. The grass starts to grow, except in this case, it's kelp. So when sea otters move into an area, they remove the grazers, they remove the urchins, and very quickly, without any grazing, we get these large kelp forests growing. And at this point, I'm going to switch and tell you that kelp is really, really important. These are all kelp forests that have grown in areas where otters are moving in rapidly. So what do we get? In areas where there are no otters, we have large populations of urchins that graze down the kelp. When otters arrive in an area, they prey on the largest items first, in this case urchins, and by removing the urchins, we end up with these thick kelp forests. And in scientific language, this gets referred to as alternate stable states. Once the system goes into one of these two states, either an urchin barrens or a kelp forest, it sits there. And what I'd like to try and convince you is that kelp forests are probably very important. And kelp really does matter. There's 4 things you need to remember about kelp. The first is that as it grows, it sequesters carbon, but it's a really leaky plant, and it tears very easily. So it leaks that carbon back into the water. That carbon, the kelp breaks up into tiny little particles, which then go on to feed entirely new food webs based on kelp detritus. And this kelp detritus, in turn, increases the productivity of nearshore ecosystems. When I was a graduate student, I had the great pleasure of working with my advisor and some of his colleagues who went to the Aleutian Islands. And they were interested in the role that this kelp plays in increasing nearshore productivity. They took mussels and they planted them in little cages at islands that had otters at them, so lots and lots of kelp. And they took similar mussels and planted them in these little cages at islands without otters. We came back a year later and harvested the mussels. The mussels at the islands with otters that had lots of kelp were 2 to 3 times bigger than the mussels at the islands without otters. When you took those mussels and ground them up and looked for the source of the carbon, the source of the carbon at islands with otters came from kelp. The source of the carbon from islands without otters came from phytoplankton. So this kelp adds an entire new source of productivity into the near shore. Very, very important. The other thing, of course, is when you build a forest, it gets populated with things. Kelp provides very important habitat for things like rockfish. And rockfish, of course, are one of the species that are in great trouble on this coast. Rockfish populations can increase by up to 80 times in areas where there are kelp forests compared to areas where there are urchin barrens. And finally, one of the things that no one ever thinks about is the fact that kelp forests, in actual fact, build nearshore breakwaters. They change the flow of water. And if you build a kelp forest along a coastline, it acts as a natural breakwater, stopping erosion on the inshore. And as the water moves through that kelp forest, it slows down. And that means larvae, little fish that are released into that kelp forest, are retained and not spread off to unsuitable habitats. So it has a huge effect on how water moves along coastlines. Okay, so now I'd like to talk just a little bit about what goes on in British Columbia. And I'd like to try and convince you that this story of otters eating urchins building kelp is true. And I'd like to show you what's happened in British Columbia, and then talk a little bit about why not everyone loves otters. So I started off years ago, 20-some odd years ago, to do a PhD on sea otters. And I did something that probably you shouldn't do when you're a PhD student. I wanted to see what the effect of sea otters was in areas with and without otters. So I set up a series of permanently marked sites. I set up permanently marked sites in areas where there were sea otters, and those were set up so that I could look at what kelp forests look like over time in areas with otters. I went into the areas where there were no otters down here in Barkley Sound, and I set up a bunch of these permanently marked sites. And the idea of these sites was to look at how urchin barrens vary over time in the absence of sea otters. And then the part I did that was probably a bit risky was I set up a bunch of these permanently marked sites in areas where there weren't otters and hoped that otters would come in and allow me to see what happens when otters arrive in an area. So I was interested in what happens when sea otters arrive into an area. I'm interested in changes over time. So I wanted to make sure I was looking at changes over time and not changes because I was sampling in different spaces every time I went back to sample. So I had set up some permanently marked sites. And I'm going to show you three graphs, and they're all the same. And so each of these permanently marked sites has a transect that goes down the middle that's 25 meters long. And then there are 5 swaths that go off the side. And once a year, we lay out tape measures along the bottom. These are all little pins. This is Suzanne putting pins in. We lay out a tape measure, and a diver goes down. They swim along one side of the tape measure with a meter stick, and they count all of the urchins and all of the algae and all of the invertebrates on one side, and then swim back the other side. Okay? So let's start by looking at some of these plots that don't have sea otters at them. And I always use this slide to point out that a tape measure has a life expectancy of about 20 minutes. It's made of carbon. Those urchins are hungry. So I'm going to show you 3 graphs. They're all the same. And so on the x-axis here, we have the average number of either urchins or algae per swath. So there were 5 of those swaths. They were 10 by 20 meters. And then we have year across the bottom. You can see I get kind of stuck doing things. And then each one of these dots then is the average abundance of urchins, and each one of these little lines is called a standard error, and it just tells you how much variation there was between those five swaths. So this is an area without otters. I want you to notice that urchin abundance has fluctuated a little bit, but there have always been urchins here, and algal abundance has come and gone a little bit, but there's really very little seaweed. So in areas without otters, at least at this one site, there is an urchin barrens, and it has stayed that way over time. If we now go and look at a plot that was set up in an area that had sea otters, your prediction would be that it's going to be all seaweed. It's going to be all kelp. And in fact, this is Sheila Thornton, who some of you may know, a very young Sheila Thornton. So yeah, these sites are dominated by kelp. And this is Gull Island. Gull Island had sea otters where I've at it probably in about 1975. It's very near the original translocation site. And again, this is just mean number on this axis, much bigger numbers than in the last one. And you're across the bottom. There's no red there. And there's no red there because there are absolutely no urchins at this site. And I just want to point out that this is when I finished my PhD. Thank goodness, because this was a really easy story to explain. This mess over here, I'm not going to talk about. It's really interesting, but I'm not going to talk about it. But what this is actually a very long-life species of kelp called tree kelp. And of course, when sea otters come in, they eat the urchins, the kelp all grows all at once. It's all the same age. And when it reaches about 20 years, it all falls down. And that's exactly what has happened here. It's declining, it crashes, and then this is all annual seaweeds, and we won't talk anymore about that, but no urchins. Okay, so what about plots with sea otters? This is the best sign I ever had that sea otters had arrived at a site. These are otterized urchins, and when they were on the ground, I knew I had sea otters. And so I'm actually going to show you two graphs. So this is Union Island. I set the site up in 1988. There were about 100 urchins per swath. We went back and visited it in the summer of 1989. There were maybe 150 urchins per swath. And then in about June of 1990, I got a phone call, and I was told that sea otters were doing science at Union Island, and the Chuklasak-Hayukut First Nations fisheries crew phoned to say there was a raft of sea otters where one of my permanent sites were. And sure enough, when we arrived in July of 1990, there were no urchins and about 300 Nereocystis bull kelp plants heading towards the surface. It was like diving in a spaghetti factory. And so you can see that kelp decline. That's just annual species being replaced by long-lived species, just like you would have after a forest fire. And then you can see that the urchins have never come back, but the kelp has remained fairly constant in abundance. So otters arrive, eat the urchins, the kelp grows. That's what's supposed to happen. And one should just stop there and not say any more, but I want to tell you that science is not always quite so straightforward. So this was a site that I set up in 1988. And you'll notice that in 1988, there were actually almost 300 urchins per swath at this site. When I returned in 1989, I had word that there were some sea otters in the area. I didn't see any. But the weird thing was, is there was kelp growing on some of my swaths, but urchin abundance really hadn't changed all that much. When I went back in 1991, it was really quite strange. Some of the swaths had urchins stacked 2 and 3 deep on them, whereas some of the other swaths had absolutely no urchins and there was kelp growing. But the abundance of urchins hadn't changed, so it was sort of like the urchins had redistributed themselves, and where they weren't, kelp was able to grow. This went on up until about 1993. By 1994, all of the urchins had finally gone, and the site has been brown algae. This is that same pterygopher story, that same tree kelp story, and then here's all that chaos afterwards. So otters came in, they ate the urchins, but it took them a while, and this is not a straightforward story. And I want to point out that it's an important story, because I told you the story about all the kelp falling down because it was all the same age. You can imagine if you have otters picking away at the urchins for a prolonged period of time, you might end up with a forest that has trees that are all different ages. So it might have a huge effect on the type of kelp forest that grows, which I'm not going to talk about, but it's what I'm really interested in. But I do want to tell you, I had a big mystery on my hands because I'm looking at a situation in which otters are feeding, but the urchins are still there. So I went away and scratched my head about it and realized maybe the otters were picking at their food. Maybe as the otters came in, they would eat an urchin, drop the urchin test to the seabed. If you were a living urchin and a dead urchin arrived on the seafloor beside you, what would you do? I'd run away. That's what I would do. And we know that urchins have fairly profound responses to their predators. So I hypothesized that maybe otters are going in, eating infrequently in the area, dropping those tests, the urchins were moving away from those tests, which is why I had them piled 6 and 7 deep, and in the areas where the urchins had run away, kelp could grow. That's a pretty easy thing to test. The other possibility was, for whatever reason, urchins were moving away, kelp was growing, and the urchins were dogpiling on top of the kelp. So I set out to test that hypothesis. So what I did was I set up a whole pile of very large quadrats, 5 meters by 5 meters, and they had pins around the edge, and I had this sort of grid rigged above them. And what we did was we conducted a bunch of experiments, and we actually mapped the sea urchins. And so in the first experiment, I pretended I was a sea otter, and I took 10 to 12 of these urchins. I chopped out the bottoms of them, and I dumped them into the middle of 3 of these quadrats and waited to see what happened. In the second experiment, I made kelp shish kebabs, and I took a piece of rebar, and I skewered 3 pieces of bull kelp, and I put those 3 kelp kebabs in the middle of 3 of these quadrats and stood back and waited to see what happened. And then the fourth experiment was just a control, because maybe urchins just don't like having more urchins in their quadrat. So I took 10 to 12 whole urchins and introduced them into the middle of 3 of these quadrats. And then we mapped what happened. So I'm just going to show you what happened in one of these quadrats. So if you add urchins into a quadrat, each one of these dots is an urchin. And this is what that quadrat looked like before I had done anything, and this is what that quadrat looked like 24 hours after I had added 10 to 12 urchins. There's no difference. If you play the kelp kebab experiment, this is what that quadrat looked like before adding kelp. Here's what it looked like 24 hours after I'd added kelp, and you can see there's a slight aggregation of urchins in the middle. And here's what it looked like 96 hours later. That aggregation is gone. So it doesn't account for these long-term aggregations. However, if you add 10 to 12 otterized urchins into the middle of a quadrat, this is the quadrat at time zero. This is the quadrat 24 hours later. This is the quadrat 96 hours later, and actually 11 to 14 hour days later. Most of those quadrats still didn't have urchins in them. And so that explains the pattern I've seen. And it suggests that these stories are sometimes a little more complicated than we expect. OK, so I'm going to recap what I've said. This is the good news part of the story. And the good news part of the story is that when we extirpated sea otters, we profoundly changed our coastal ecosystems. We removed the predator that controls urchins. And urchins, in turn, of course, control kelp. When sea otters are reintroduced and move back into their historic range, the first thing they tend to feed on are these really large red urchins. And when they remove the grazers, we essentially end up with kelp forests instead of urchin barrens. And that's good for coastal productivity, it's good for fish, it's good for the way coastal currents work. But it's not that good if you're a commercial shellfish harvester. If you dive for geoducks, dive for urchins, or dig for clams, because this guy is a predator. He is a predator that doesn't have size limits, doesn't have area closures, and doesn't have a quota. And unfortunately, of course, when we took sea otters out of the system, we removed the major predator. And in the ensuing 150 years, shellfish became more abundant and they became larger in size. In the late 1950s, with the advent of scuba and easy ways to ship things, huge markets developed for many of these invertebrate species. And in actual fact, some of these species represent some of the most valuable marine fisheries we have on the coast of British Columbia. We fish for crabs, we fish for urchins, we fish for geoducks, and of course we used to fish for abalone, and I'm going to talk about those guys down the bottom. And so it's a little more complicated than saying sea otters came, all is well, because sea otters literally threaten the livelihood of commercial fishermen. And of course, a lot of people have become very used to an enormous abundance of shellfish, including First Nations communities who harvested these species historically. But I want to talk a little bit about the commercial end of things, and I'll go back and talk about the First Nations end. So these are geoducks, and geoducks are our most valuable invertebrate fishery in British Columbia right now. They're a big clam. They bury about 1 meter deep in the sediment. They're really quite heavy. They're many, many kilograms. But the really interesting thing about geoducks is when the fishery started in the early 1970s, DFO was responsible for managing geoducks, and so the first thing you need to know is the age structure of your stock. So as the geoducks were harvested, they started to age them. In 1972, the oldest geoduck that they had was 164 years old. The bulk of the population was between 100 and 148 years old. Sea otters were probably ecologically extinct 150 years ago. So in all likelihood, what happened was geoducks probably occurred below 100 meters, where sea otters prefer not to dive. When the sea otters were extirpated, geoducks, as they spawned, the larvae simply started to occupy this beautiful empty real estate that seemed to be lacking in large predators. And so we basically have a fishery made possible by the absence of a predator. We've put that predator back into the system, and sea otters love geoducks. Red urchins. We also have a very valuable fishery for red urchins, for greens as well, less so, but big fisheries. And for years it was assumed that red urchins were what is called an R-selected species. They lived very short lives, they produced lots of gametes, and they had lots of recruitment, and then they died. A fellow named Tom Ebert at Oregon State University had always disagreed with this. He felt that in actual fact, urchins were quite long-lived, but it was very, very difficult to demonstrate this because they lay down annuli, but there's a lot of annual rings. There's a lot of debate about what those annual rings mean. But Tom Ebert realized that in the late 1950s, there was a really cool experiment that was conducted, and it was called nuclear testing. Because when those nuclear tests occurred in the late 1950s, they released isotopes into the atmosphere, radioactive isotopes that were then incorporated into the skeletons of calcium carbonate animals, including urchins. So Tom Ebert teamed up with a nuclear physicist and asked the nuclear physicist to find where the strontium began in the skeleton of a sea urchin. Tom then went back and counted the rings and came up with age estimates for sea urchins that suggest that an 18-centimeter sea urchin may be as old as 180 years. Number two, old, long-lived species. And I just want to point out that sea otters also forage in the intertidal, and they eat clams. And I've spent a lot of time working in the Chekalasat-Kayukat First Nations territory, sitting eating my sandwich with my back up against a bank that is just chock-a-block full of clams, particularly butter clams. And obviously First Nations people managed to make a living coexisting with sea otters. And in all likelihood, what I suspect is sea otters weren't too interested hanging around in shallow intertidal areas where the people that hunted them lived. And so I suspect that sea otters avoided humans as much as they could, and in doing so, made it possible for people to harvest shellfish. The deep subtidal was the home of the sea otter. The shallow subtidal and littoral would have been home for people. Okay, but what I want to talk about in the last 10 minutes or so is a conundrum that we face. So sea otters, when I started working on them, were listed as endangered. As the population grew, they were downlisted to threatened. And then in 2009, they became a species of special concern. So a species that is probably still threatened by human effects, an oil spill, in short. But they're on their way to being out of trouble. In contrast, the northern abalone was threatened when I started working on sea otters, or became threatened while I was working on sea otters. And then in 2011, it was listed as endangered. The Species at Risk Act in Canada requires that any species at risk, any species that is listed, you have to have a recovery plan, and you have to ensure that that species recovers. So I have a question for you. What do you do when one threatened species eats another? And so this is a picture taken by fisheries officer Steph Olson, and I don't know if you can see this, but this otter is chowing down, this special concern otter is chowing down on that endangered abalone. And so I simply ask the question, how did sea otters and their prey manage to coexist? And it would be hard to work on abalone. Abalone are valuable, they're poached, and they've been heavily fished. So it's really hard when you look at an abalone population to know what has been done to it in the past. So I instead decided to look at the effects of sea otters on a model species, and I chose this guy here. This is the red turban snail. And I chose the red turban snail because it has most of the life history characteristics of an abalone. It hasn't been fished, it's abundant, and sea otters like to eat them. And so the first thing any ecologist does if they don't really know what to do is they count things. So I went to 8 sites with sea otters and 8 sites without sea otters, and I counted all of the red turban snails in 30 quadrats at each of those sites. And what would be your prediction? 8 sites with sea otters, 8 sites without sea otters. What's the abundance going to be like? Less in areas with otters, more in areas without. Yeah, that's what I thought. That was my hypothesis. So this graph, I'm going to show you two that look like this. I like doing things over time, apparently. This is just the number of years I did it at each of those 8 sites. The blue is always going to be no otters. The red is always going to be otters. And this is just the number of red turban snails per quadrat. And you don't need to be a statistician to see that there's no difference between the red and the blue there. There is no difference in the abundance of red turban snails in areas with and without sea otters, much to my surprise. So the other thing ecologists do when they don't know what to do is after they've counted the things, they measure them. So we also measured all of our snails. And this is where the interesting information comes out. So it's a huge graph. There's one take-home message. The top here is otters present. The bottom is otters absent. Each one of these is a size frequency histogram. So these are snails that are 10 millimeters. These are snails that are 40 millimeters, and so on. And this is percent. All I want you to notice is that in areas with sea otters, there are virtually no snails larger than 40 millimeters. In areas with otters, 30 to 40% of the population is made up by large snails. Sea otters eat big ones. Sea otters, because they have such tremendous energy requirements, can't afford to waste their time picking up tiny little prey. So they eat the large ones, leaving behind this population of small snails. But if you think about what, and there it is, you can see it clearly the same type of graph. So the blue is the size of snails in areas without otters, and the red is areas with otters. But if you think carefully about what I've just told you, I've told you that there are the same number of snails in areas with otters as there are in areas without otters, and I've told you that the snails in areas with otters are smaller. So that means that there has to be more small snails in areas with otters than in areas without otters. And to me, that's surprising. And it begs the question, why? Well, one possible reason could be these guys. And so I set out to try and figure out whether or not there was a difference in the abundance of crabs in areas with and without sea otters. So at each of those sites I had played with snails at, I set some crab pots. I soaked them for 12 hours. I came back, picked up the crab pots. I caught 29 crabs in the areas without otters. I caught no crabs in the areas with otters. And the reason is pretty obvious. Otters eat crabs. So for anyone who's followed any sort of ecological literature and looked at those snails that you see, the beautiful snails from the tropics and places like that, all of those ornaments that you see on snails are thought to be a defense against crabs. Crabs are known to be a tremendous predator of snails. And so I was pretty convinced that crabs were eating a lot of snails in areas without otters. And I have to tell a silly story about myself now. In addition to measuring and counting things, I collect stuff. And so every time I put a quadrat down and there were dead snails in the quadrat, I put them in a plastic bag and brought them to the surface. I came back between trips, dropped all these bags of snails off on the deck of our house, went back into the field, came home. My husband, of course, is coming and going as well. In the field, there's a little note from him to say that the snails that I have left on the deck smell. Clean them up, please. So I dutifully washed them all, put them in little bags that were labeled Chucklesett Bay where there are otters, Barkley Sound where there are no otters, air dried them, made them nice and clean, and put them in two bags on the kitchen table to show what a dutiful wife I could be. And the next morning I was getting up drinking my coffee, feeling very virtuous, looking at these bags of snails, and I realized to my horror that I had been collecting these snails for 5 years and not noticed something. The snails that came from areas with otters were all broken in this axis. So there's the bottom of the snail. They're all broken perpendicular to the snail base. If you looked at the snails in areas without otters, all of the snails were broken parallel to the base. Two completely different fracture patterns from two areas. And so I suspected that this is what a crab does and that's what an otter does. And well, that was something I could test as well. Well, I didn't test it. I had two students, Nicholas Davies and a fellow named Aaron Rutledge Yeomans, conduct a series of experiments in which they fed snails to crabs. And they gave the crabs choices in the size of snail they got to eat. So here's their tank set up. They give them the snails and then sat back to see what happened. And hopefully you can see this. Whoops. No, it's this really, really sensitive.
It doesn't look like it's linked down there.
It should, yeah.
Interesting.
No, it's just, I played before. There we go. Okay, so I don't know if you can see, but there's the crab with the snail. And you see how he's going in? He's going in through the base. And he's going to chip away at it. And he's going to actually make something that looks like this down here. And they did this repeatedly. And this is a graphic that's hard to understand at first, but this is, it's simply a choice experiment. So this is a line right here that is the line of no choice. Nick and Aaron gave the crabs a choice of snails that were 10 to 20 centimeters, 20 to 30 centimeters, and 30 to 40 centimeters. Wherever one of those lines crosses this line, it means the crabs don't care. And what it says to me is crabs really don't want to eat big snails, but they're pretty happy to eat little ones. So crabs like little snails. So that begs the question, what do sea otters do? Well, I could do this stuff in the aquarium at Banfield Marine Sciences Center, and I realized I can do this in an aquarium too. It just happens to be the Vancouver Aquarium. So I arrived over here a number of years ago with Nick and a bag of snails, and we fed Milo snails. This is Milo, so you guys will know the date. So this is a very frustrated Milo, you'll notice. He knows he should be able to eat it. But Milo, of course, is missing a very crucial item. Very frustrated. I know how to do this. I know how to do this. Whoops. Me? Okay, I'm going to keep going. So anyway, Milo was very frustrated because Milo did miss something that was very critical. Milo needed a rock. And Aaron Recksteiner has been working on the central coast of British Columbia for the last year. And a couple of years, last winter, she took this picture of sea otter eating a turbid snail. So yes, sea otters do eat turbid snails. But they really do need a rock, and when they've cracked them, look at what they look like. So I couldn't do it at the aquarium. Aaron did it for me in the wild. So anyway, sea otters do eat snails, and sea otters appear to like large snails. And so right now you're all going, Gene, yeah, very interesting. Crabs like little snails. Sea otters like big snails. Who cares? Well, I'd like to argue that this, in part, explains the story of how sea otters may have coexisted with their prey. And my story, my hypothesis, far from demonstrated yet, is that when we removed sea otters from the system, we changed the evolutionary pressure that their prey were under. And for most animals that release their gametes into the water, that are broadcast spawners, the bigger you are, the more gametes you produce. And if you're a hard-bodied animal, and you've lost sea otters, the only thing that's out there to eat you is a crab. And if you can grow really, really quickly when you're little and get to be big, you're going to grow quickly through the sizes where you're most vulnerable to things like crabs, and you're going to become big where you get to make lots and lots of babies. So there is a lot of pressure for animals to shift through natural selection their life history parameters, what they do. And when we take an otter out of the system, we're looking at 150, 200 years of evolutionary pressure that was very, very different than the preceding 6,000 years. And so I think it probably does matter that sea otters like big prey and crabs like little prey. And so this is the story. If you think about these guys, which are broadcast spawners, you can fit an awful lot more eggs and sperm into a big snail than you can into a small snail. And I want you guys, this is a complicated graph, but I want you guys to think about a population of snails. Here they are. And so this is their size. It's just like those histograms I showed you early. And this is the percentage, if you like, on this axis. So in an original population with otters, this is, let's say, the average size of a snail. When we take the sea otters out of the system, all of a sudden what happens is we end up with a population that has become larger. Simply because if you're big, you get to produce more gametes. If you put all of your energy into growing when you're little, you're going to grow more quickly and get through that dangerous stage when other things might like to eat you. If we put the otters back into that population, what would happen to all of these snails that have the gene for waiting to reproduce when they're big? Would they get to reproduce? No. So it would be the guys that reproduced when they were little that would survive. And the population would shift back to a population dominated by small snails. And I don't know that this is what is happening with my snails. It's very difficult to demonstrate that. But it suggests that when we look at many of the species that we harvest now, and we try and think about how on earth they coexisted with sea otters, we might have to realize that the strategies that they were using when sea otters were abundant are very different than the strategies we have come to know them to use. And we may see changes in the behavior, changes in the reproductive strategies, changes in the life history parameters of many of those species. Doesn't mean we're going to be able to fish them. It doesn't mean they're going to become hyperabundant again. But they're probably not going to be driven extinct by sea otters eating them. Sea otters have been eating these things for 600,000 years. I suspect they're going to do okay. Okay, but I have one last thing I need to tell you about, because I've told you the good news story about sea otters coming back, and we've got lots of kelp. And I've told you that things like to eat kelp. Well, there was something that really liked to eat kelp, and that was this guy here, the Steller sea cow. And it's quite a fascinating story, really. The Steller sea cow was the largest member of the order Sirenia. It was a dugong. And most of you will know dugongs as animals that eat seagrass in the tropics. This was the only temperate water Sirenian. It was 9 meters long. It weighed 6 to 9 tons. And it ate kelp. And we wouldn't know about this animal, save for fossil records from the Ice Age, except that when Phidias Bering sailed across to find the United States or find Alaska, on his way back, he was shipwrecked. And he happened to have on his boat a man named George Wilhelm Steller, who was a naturalist. And George Wilhelm Steller got shipwrecked on the Commander Islands. He was the only member of the crew that was happy because he got to naturalize for 6 months unimpeded. And he described the Steller sea cow, these large, cumbersome animals that stumbled about the shallow subtidal grazing on kelp. And the Commander Islands, where these guys occurred, was probably the last stand for the Steller sea cow. The Commander Islands were never occupied. Steller sea cows were probably ill-adapted to humans when they arrived in North America. They were basically 6 to 9 tons of easily accessible meat. So George Wilhelm Steller described the Steller sea cow in 1741. When his journals were published, the Russian fur traders that set across the Aleutian Islands stopped first at the Commander Islands to stock up on meat, and the Steller sea cow was extinct by 1768. I like thinking about things that could have been, and it strikes me that the Steller sea cow, of course, completes the story. The Steller sea cow was the animal that ate the kelp that the otters made. And so we'll never know what it does, but you can only imagine having an animal creating all those little pieces of detritus that further fuel nearshore animals. I mean, you look at a big storm and all that kelp comes up on the beach, maybe it went into Steller sea cow instead. Okay, so I'd just like to point out that I keep saying I and me, and of course it never is I and me. I have been very fortunate in having, over my 20-something years, a plethora of people work with me. These are just a few of them. That's Graham, my husband, down the bottom, and Leah Seville right here, who has worked with me for 20-something years. And many of the beautiful underwater pictures you've seen have been taken by this woman here, Lynn Lee, who's a graduate student at Simon Fraser University. And of course, physical help is one thing. We also need financial help to do this type of work. And with John's forbearance, I'm going to actually tell a very quick story. When I was a graduate student, just starting out, I had a grant fall apart on me. I'd been promised a whole body of money and it didn't come through. And I was all ready to go into the field and all of a sudden I had no money. Murray Newman said, "How much do you need, Jane?" And I told him. And he said, "Here it is. If you get your grant, you can pay it back. If you don't worry about it." So the aquarium actually bailed me out of my second field season by doing that. I did get the grant. I paid the aquarium back, but it made a tremendous difference to my career as a graduate student. So I received support from a number of people, and I work in the Chekalasat Kayukat First Nations territory, for which I am very grateful. And thank you to all the colleagues and friends who have come and helped me catch fish. Count fish, count snails, even Lance has been forced to count sea otters in his time.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jane. So we'll go ahead and open it up for a few questions. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll come over with the microphone.
I put them all to sleep with graphs.
Hi. I had a question about the urchin barrens. Why don't they self-regulate? When there's no kelp, don't they die off?
Great question. So urchins are amazing. All echinoderms can just stop growing. And in fact, they can grow negatively, which is part of the problem with aging them. So when urchins don't have food, they just stop growing and they can actually start to digest their own skeleton and shrink in size. So they're probably not regulated by food ever. So yeah, and it's a peculiarity of echinoderms, or at least of urchins and sea stars.
I had one more. Where is geoduck eaten? I've never seen it on a menu.
Geoduck, yeah, geoduck is very, very valuable. Most of it goes straight to Asia. It used to be that we could, when you had clam chowder on the BC ferries, it was king clam siphons, that was geoduck, but now the entire clams, they're shipped live to largely Chinese markets. Very, very valuable. Yeah. Maybe you can buy them at specialty seafood stores, but you won't see them in the grocery store, that's for sure. Yeah, very valuable fishery. The geoduck fishermen, by the way, have helped me with a lot of my snail work, so.
We live in a country at a time where we have a federal government that seems to care only about things that have economic value. I wonder if you could, I hope the world is listening. I work at the Vancouver Aquarium. Could you talk a little bit about the economic consequences of the sea otter recovery?
The economic consequences. The economic consequences are the loss of those very, very large fisheries. That pales, I think, in comparison to the initial hardship that First Nations communities feel. Because if you think about it, if you are the Kayukat Chekalsat First Nation, when we introduced sea otters, we had no idea what was going to happen. They were introduced before this understanding of the ecological role of sea otters occurred. But so sea otters sort of expanded through, for example, the Chekalsat Kayukat First Nation before otters' role was even recognized. And there was no option to figure out how humans and sea otters might coexist. So I have more worry about that. Large-scale commercial fisheries and sea otters will not coexist, period. Sea otters play a vital role in our nearshore ecosystem, and I would argue that the downstream benefits of an ecosystem that is working properly, the economic benefits of that far exceed the immediate returns from these large-scale fisheries. The problem is we all want dollars and cents. We want a line with a nice thing down the bottom that said this is how much sea otters are worth. And you can do that. It's called ecosystem services, and people make these calculations. But I would argue, how much is the air we breathe worth? There was a wonderful paper published, actually my supervisor Jim Estes was one of the authors on it, in a journal a year and a half ago that talks about carbon credits. You guys all know what carbon credits are. So I'm afraid I kind of scoff at carbon credits. If you want to use carbon, just recognize you're using it. And if you want to fly in an airplane to Vancouver, reduce your carbon footprint elsewhere, but don't pretend you're being carbon neutral or green. You're using carbon. And so I've always had a problem with these carbon credit things. But Jim and a bunch of his colleagues got together and looked at kelp as a species that sequesters carbon. And it does. It takes carbon out of the atmosphere. It puts it into plants. And any detritus from kelp, the bulk of the detritus from kelp, gets shunted off into the deep sea, where it really is being sequestered. So there, for example, is a benefit that doesn't have a line drawn across the bottom of it with some sort of value. But kelp, for example, probably provides some huge value in terms of its ability to sequester carbon. How much is that worth compared to a geoduck or an urchin fishery? I have no way of answering that question. And I don't know if I've answered yours, but
Carbon credits do have value.
Is it because carbon credits have value that a government would recognize? I know Jim has worked on this, Jim Estes, who you referred to. Does the value of those carbon credits exceed the economic loss to invertebrate fisheries?
I don't think we know how much kelp we have, for example, in British Columbia, to know the answer to that. Mm-hmm. But I mean, what is the change in finfish fisheries going to be, for example? We simply don't know those things. In my view, most of these large invertebrate fisheries are probably gold mine fisheries. We're mining a resource that accumulated quite quickly, but there's no reason to expect that it's going to continue to accumulate. I don't think I answered that, Lance, sorry.
Wait. It's okay. So is it correct to think of the kelp as the temperate forest of the sea?
Yeah, it's quite different in some ways. It's much faster growing. It's much shorter lived. It's much more ephemeral. But yes, it plays that same role.
Are there any kelp fisheries?
Yeah, they do fish kelp, certainly in California. So when you eat ice cream and it hasn't got ice crystals in it, when you put lipstick on, when you put makeup on, it's called a colloid, the substance that stops particles from sinking, that holds particles in suspension, it's called a colloid. So alginates come from kelp, and so kelp is harvested to produce things like agar and various alginates. And so certainly in places like California, it's harvested commercially with these big mowers. There's been several efforts to harvest kelp in British Columbia. So far, they've failed. There are kelp fisheries, of course, throughout the world, largely for intertidal kelp. So yeah, there's kelp fisheries. The difference is, I think, is that kelp isn't as long-lived. And you can take the top off of many kelp plants, and it simply grows up to replace it. So it's more like harvesting bamboo or something, I guess. Yeah.
Has there been any evidence of movement of sea otter populations northward as the waters around here start warming?
That's a great question. Sea otters occur as far south as California, and they probably occurred all the way down to sort of the cold upwelled portions of Baja, Mexico. So they went really quite a long ways south. There are three different subspecies, though, and the ones in the south are smaller. They're Enhydrolutris nereus. We have one called Enhydrolutris kenyani, and it goes through the Aleutians, and then there's a third subspecies in the western Pacific. I don't know that anyone has looked at the effects of climate change on sea otters, at least not that I'm aware of. So I can't answer that question. But given they can exist in California, I think they've got a long ways to go before there's any problems on this coast.
I have a question. The effort that's used to see how many sea otters there are along the entire BC coast, is it an equal amount of effort that's used, or is that effort focused in certain areas, and that's why we see most of the sea otters in those areas?
Note that most of the sea otter counts that are done by DFO. There's a variety of other people contribute to those data. But essentially, there are areas that are used as reference areas that sort of tell us that sea otter, like Chacoset Bay, tells us what an equilibrium population is doing, and it's doing okay, so we can assume populations elsewhere are doing okay. And so the coast is sort of divided up into sections, and those sections get surveyed not all in the same year, but at different times. So no, it's not concentrated in any one area. So the population growth we see is real.
And actually, I have another question about the fisheries. So you mentioned there isn't likely going to be a commercial fishery for sea otters, but you didn't say anything about a potential traditional fishery.
So there is already a treaty agreement for the New Chalna Tribal Council to take to allocate and take a small number of sea otters that would be harvested for traditional use. So yes, that exists. I don't think we will ever see a large-scale fur hunt. I would hope not anyway. But
right. Any other questions?
Is there any evidence that, say, transient killer whales are eating more sea otters?
I don't think so. As I say, I Every time I see a killer whale, I'm supposed to put what I'm doing down and pick up a camera and photo ID it. And I always see killer whales when I'm halfway through a sea otter count that's going to take me all day long and it's perfect weather. That's always what happens. So I have watched transient killer whales. Lance probably knows this better than me because I gave all this information to his graduate student, but I can't remember. I've probably watched transient killer whales killing stuff. In Chacozo Bay, Cayucat Sound, where I work, once or twice every summer, so let's say 60 times, between 40 and 60 times. In all of those times, I have seen a killer whale approach and bother a sea otter twice, and in both those cases, it was young transients, and in both those cases, the sea otter swam away. I have, however, watched sea otters watching killer whales killing seals. So my impression is that killer whales aren't particularly interested in eating sea otters, providing there is fattier prey around. There are stories of people seeing sea otters flying through the air with killer whales killing them. I haven't seen that yet. So.
Let's do one last question.
Were there ever sea otters in the waters of the southern mainland?
Of the Strait of Georgia? Probably. There are some records of sea otters in middens in areas around Souk. When the Spaniards came into the Strait of Georgia, they knew what sea otters were. They were very good at trading in sea otters, and they report whales, they report seals, they report sea lions, no mention of sea otters. There were hundreds of thousands of people living around the Salish Sea, hundreds of thousands. And there probably, if there were sea otters in the Strait of Georgia, there probably were never a lot of them. So my suspicion is there's no reason why there shouldn't be sea otters in the Salish Sea. They swim in here periodically. But they were probably extirpated by the very, very large population of human beings that live here. And in many cases, the middens that those bones would be in are underwater because of changing sea levels. So there were probably sea otters in the Strait of Georgia, but probably never a lot. The person that does a lot of work on sea otters and middens right now is a fellow named Ian McKechnie, who just finished his PhD at the University of Victoria. And you can, if you Google him, you can find a bunch of papers he's published on looking at sea otter bones in middens, up and down the BC coast, actually.
All right, thank you very much. Jane, for coming to the Vancouver Aquarium tonight.
If anyone wants to look at pelts, they feel free if they want to.
You are welcome if you're here at the Vancouver Aquarium to come down and touch some of the sea otter pelts that Jane has brought with her today. Just a couple of announcements before we head out. We do have a program this Saturday, Arctic Dialogue, a discussion. It's during the day here at the aquarium at 12:30 in the Underwater Arctic Gallery, where we're going to be talking about some of the challenges that the Arctic is facing. And we're actually asking folks to share their perspectives. So we're not going to have a presentation per se. Rather, we're going to ask people to share their perspective. And we're going to have some very unique audience members. We have a number of folks coming in from the Arctic that will be joining us. So we'll get to hear their voice and the voice of scientists and underwater archaeologists that work for Parks Canada. So if you want, you can be a part of that and bring your voice to that discussion as well. We have another program coming up on November 13th. It's not on the website yet, so this is your tip. It's on harbor porpoises. Anna Hall will be coming and talking about them. If you have any questions from tonight's program, feel free to send us an email or give us a call and let us know. We'd be happy to get an answer for you. Thank you very much for coming tonight, and have a good evening. We'll see you again soon.